Lowther from McGill University in Canada, who will tell us something about design of electromagnetic devices from simulation to reality. So, Dave, please, the floor is yours.
Decisions allow us to guide the design process and allow us to accelerate the design process, hopefully. So information basically comes from relationships in the data that we generate or the measurements that you take on real devices or on models. And if you don't have models, then you end up by using a real device. And if you do have models, then you generate a lot of data and try to figure out what it might mean. And just to finish this piece off, people also talk a lot about knowledge, which I'm not going to talk about today, because there's really three levels that people worry about: knowledge, information, and data, and they're all very different. I'm not really going to talk about knowledge. Knowledge really is a high-level abstraction of patterns that you find in the information. The information is derived from the data, and that gives you a set of operational rules. And most people, when they're doing design, use a lot of knowledge or experience, practical stuff they've learned. Okay, so that's the beginning of some of the stuff to do with simulation and why we need it. Now I want to take a little trip back in history. I want to go back further than the beginning of CompuMac. I want to go back to around about 1820, which is, for those of you who've heard me talk before, really a starting point in this business. Prior to 1820, electromechanical energy conversion didn't exist. It never even been dreamt of. In 1820, as we all know, Oersted, some say accidentally, whether it was accidentally or not, discovered the link between current flow and magnetism. And basically, that discovery led to where we are today in terms of electrical engineering and electromagnetic devices. And then Ampere, of course, very quickly came up with a mathematical relationship, which basically gives us one of the two fundamental laws that we use, at least in low-frequency electromagnetics. The issue had been that people had known about magnetic forces and electric forces for centuries. In fact, society had used them for centuries. But what the discovery of Oersted did, obviously, and you all know this, was basically give you a way of controlling force and converting electrical energy into mechanical energy. And that was revolutionary, literally revolutionary. Because it allowed us to basically look at energy which we can deliver in an electrical form very flexibly, very easily, and generate mechanical output. And that basically gave us electric motors, actuators, and all the other devices that we kind of take for granted today. Of course, the other half of the game, around about 1821, Faraday actually built a source of a very simple unpolar motor. In 1831, he put the other half of the problem together by telling us how magnetic and electric fields were related sort of the inverse way. And those two laws are really the only two we use. We talk about Maxwell's equations and solving them, but really the only bits, at least the low frequency community uses, is Faraday and Ampere. And that basically resulted in the creation of generators and sensors and all these other systems. So the two pieces together gave us generators for creating electrical energy and motors for creating mechanical energy and everything that goes along with that. So by about 1831, we got everything we need for power engineering. It's kind of interesting. Just in passing, at this point in time, electric motors, just electric motors, in industrial applications, use 28% of the electrical energy generated in the world every year. 80% of generated electrical energy is created through electromechanical energy conversion as well. 100% of it goes through transformers. So in terms of the impact of kind of being able to do low frequency calculations and design, it's fairly significant in terms of the global energy usage. So as I just said, devices have revolutionized society. The problem is that we've got to build them, manufacture them to achieve objectives like force, size, cost, reliability, and so on. And say from the beginning we had those two equations, but of course in 1861-1864 Maxwell put together the pieces into one suite of equations, which he now knows as Maxwell's equations, which of course, as we all know, is also the wrong name for them, the Maxwell Heaviside equations. I put 1861 in for fun, because that's when paper on Maxwell and Faraday's lines of force was published. And it's exactly 41 years after Ørsted did his experiment. And today is 41 years since CompuMax started. So that's the same space of time. Which is a bit frightening when you think about it, but in 41 years in the 19th century, the whole foundation of electromagnetic field theory and everything else was laid. And in the last 41 years, we've been trying to do it on computers. So how well have we done? What the work of these guys through the 19th century did, of course, was to tell us what the topology of an electromagnetic device looks like. And I'm not going to leave this overhead up long. It's just there to remind me that it's interesting that the topological structures are defined in the equations, and therefore the structures of all electromechanical systems are defined through that. You've got this interesting linking of electric and magnetic fields. So it's all useful, but the question is, as it was in the 19th century, how do you build a real device? Well, in the 19th century, and it's still a bit true today, you guess a solution to a set of specifications, then try to modify it. So here's a motor from 1844, so that's 17 years prior to Maxwell writing down the equations, and 13 years after Faraday wrote down his equation. It doesn't look terribly like what you would expect a modern electrical machine to look like. And the reason it doesn't look very like that is because the theory was pretty shaky. It was difficult to solve the equations. People were working from knowledge, and the knowledge was being gained by information. The information was coming out of experiments. And the question on this one, again, is how do you change that design to get out a specific torque? And in 1844, there wasn't really a very good answer to that question. And on top of that, as we all know, building physical devices is extremely expensive and very slow. And so you have to find a faster way of doing that. And people, humans in general, like to build models. So you build a model, build a virtual system, which kind of allows you to predict what's going to happen, allows you to generate the data. And basically, the key to building a design system is to have an appropriate forward model. And this starts to maybe hopefully link back into this concept of confidence of building effective, appropriate forward models. And one note down here, which I think many people have said, and I remember Chari was saying it to me back in the 1980s, that engineers are basically model builders, and they're users of models, and that's what our job is. So if we look at an electromagnetic device, what have we got? Well, there's a little picture here, which is not particularly informative. Our motor is just a transfer function from input to an output. And our problem is to build a model that has the appropriate transfer function. You can do this from equivalent circuits, you can do it from all sorts of ways, and people have tried over the years, and they've built models, they've built ways of trying to approximate this transfer function. But that on its own isn't sufficient for design. That just tells you that if you have a design, this is how it works. To make it work, you need to be able to iterate. And this goes back to, I think, what Professor Costa was saying a moment ago. Let's look at the amount of optimization work that's gradually been growing through the years, because it's very clear in this community that although the forward model is useful to do design, you need that feedback loop. So, the theory is, and you get to about 1976 or just before that, that in order to get a really good forward model, Maxwell told us how to do it. All we have to do is solve the field equations. And that was kind of tricky up until the invention of the digital computer, and I'm going to explore that in a moment. But if we could get a full field solution, the theory goes, then we've got a good forward model, then we can do design. And in 1976, there were several groups around Europe, North America, and Japan that were really worried about this problem. The group of Rutherford Labs, run by Bill Trowbridge, who started CompuMag, had a problem in high energy physics. They had to design magnets that did particular things. And to do that, you needed tools. You couldn't keep designing magnets that were 4 or 5 or 6 meters long and saying it didn't work, let's build another one. Same time, big machines people were having problems with large electrical machines. They couldn't make them work, they were having failures, they didn't understand why. So that group got together and basically said, let's see if we can solve the field problems. Where can we go from here? So the goal, one goal of this whole business is to create virtual models which give you, address all the issues in design, and that's a lot of them, subject to constraints on the design process. And the constraints are not that, given the world's biggest computer, can I solve this field problem? That's not really very much use to anybody. The problems are usually, can you do it fast enough for a design process, and can you do it cheaply enough for a design process? So all this leads us to the fact that design is an iterative process. It involves lots of solution candidates being looked at. It involves information being generated that allow the feedback loop to work. And the trade-offs that we're playing with are approximation. What approximations are valid? What can you use? And how long are you willing to waste or take before you can get a solution out? I'll keep coming back to this concept of time, because being able to solve a problem in 3 or 4 months is very nice, but for a design engineer, it's not very much use. Every iteration increases information. That's the whole point of an iterative process. And each model gives you a different, every formal model gives you a different level of information. So the question at any point in time between 1844 and 2017 is, how much information do you need to reach a design decision? How much information can you get? And what budget have you got available to reach a design decision? As engineers, the budget always seems to come in. So that takes me on to talking about a virtual model. We know that theoretically the perfect solution to field equations gives us a good virtual model. But the question is, what do we need? What are the specifications for a good forward model? Well, obviously, accurately estimating the field distribution, subject to constraints and simplifications. And the assumptions that we're playing with in generating this is that all the performance parameters can be obtained from the field. And once you've got the field, you can figure out the losses, the forces, the heating, the electromagnetic stresses. Everything falls out of that. That's a nice idea. And all of that was just about impossible to do at the level that we needed it until digital computers came along, and with them, CompuMag. So I'm going to skip through the next bit very quickly, because you've got other talks to listen to this morning, and I want to get on to some other stuff. But we all know about numerical simulation. That's what we do. That's our job. We want to map the continuous field equations into discrete equations. We want to basically figure out how many degrees of freedom you're going to need to solve the problem. And we want to make these solutions non-trivial. So computers basically allow us to do that, or at least they seem to allow us to do that. All we have to do is translate what Maxwell said into systems of equations that can be solved on a computer. And what could be easier than that, said everybody in 1976. Well, 41 years later. Yes, we're still saying the same thing, but that seems to have got there as far as we wanted to. The issue, of course, as we all know, is that the solutions are subject to geometric structural devices, electromagnetic properties of materials, the excitations you put on, external events, multi-physics, and so on. So you end up with very large numbers of equations, and that's the first sort of problem that we ran into when we look at computing systems. So what I want to do is to say, okay, let's go back again to the beginning of CompuMag, and let's have a look at what computing could do, and that might give us a view of why we've got to where we are and what we can do going in the future. I said, why we want to do things. I've talked a little bit about what it is that we need to do, and I now want to look at the computer side of the game. I'm going to start, well, not really at CompuMag, because 1976, all the work has been done on mainframe computers, and the biggest mainframes people could get their hands on. So it's limited to a very small part of society, if you like. And I want to basically make a statement that I want to look at things, and this is where we might all disagree in the audience. I want to look at state of computing with a cost of computing of a computer of about $4,000 in cost. And the reason for choosing that, as Pete Sylvester once said, is that if you can get a $4,000 computer to do this, every engineer can have one. Because after all, back in the 1970s, that's what an electric typewriter cost, and every secretary could have one. So if you can buy for a secretary, maybe you can buy for an engineer. So that's the reason for the $4,000 target. And in the early 1980s, we could actually do some stuff, microprocessors around, life was beginning. But you couldn't get very much on them. I'll show you sort of what you could do in a moment. About 1,000 degrees of freedom, which today everybody gets life at, so you can't do anything with 1,000 degrees of freedom. But remember, in 1980, you couldn't do anything anyhow. I mean, there was nothing other than equivalent circuits or mainframe machines. 2D static problems, and we could handle non-linearity of permanent magnets. And if you look at a picture of a simulation done in about 1981, this was largely pre-PC. It was based on a microprocessor that had 64 kilobytes of memory and 720 kilobytes of removable storage. And that's a 1,000 degree of freedom, non-linear problem modeling generator, which, for its time, was, according to the people who used it, fairly significant. Of course, there was also the ability to look at some of the pictures outside of that as well. And this is basically the same system. These are post-processed images from about 35 years ago. LSI, large-scale integration, of course, revolutionized computing, and you all know this bit, so I skip this. 71, 74, the 80, 80. And as we move forward, we basically end up with the PC in the early 1980s. And this graph is attempting to show the gaining computer power for about a $4,000 machine. So that's these days would be a desktop workstation. And I've done it in terms of MIPS. I should have made it flops, but I was having a problem trying to get flop counts for everything, so MIP counts are easy. It's kind of an interesting picture. So that's where roughly that 1,000 degree of freedom model is, in that by the early 90s, 3D problems on a $4,000 machine were feasible. Depending on how much disk you could afford, how much memory you could afford, you could go from 30,000 to about 300,000 degrees of freedom on a small machine, if you wanted to wait long enough for a solution, which could be days. And then somewhere around about the early 2000s, I just put this one in as a pointer, because it's quite a complex problem to do full non-linear transient six-axis motion on a PC, and that's somewhere around there. The interesting questions on this graph, and this is a log scale, of course, is that this is the Moore's law picture, and this is the recent stuff. And I've specifically made it MIPS per core, because to get around this flattening problem, of course, almost all manufacturers now will run multiple cores. And our job is, how do we use those multiple cores on the machine? This is disk sizes. I'm going to hurry through these, otherwise the chairman's going to throw me out of here in a moment. Again, they look very similar in terms of the curves. If you overlay those two curves, in fact, they're virtually identical because the manufacturing technologies are very similar. But we've gone from about, when we did 2D, having less than 10 megabytes of drive on the machine, to something in the region of a terabyte or more around now. And you can look at the installed memories as well. And those have gone from the 640 kilobytes that everybody remembers on early PCs to something in the region of a terabyte or two or three or six or ten on your PC, depending on what you're willing to spend. But again, I'm keeping this to about $4,000. Bottom line, processors grow at 40% per year, memories grow at 40% per year, disks grow at 40% per year, and intercommunication speeds don't. If you put the data rates on LANs in, it's slightly less, it's about 30 or 35% per year. So now, 30 years later, 2010, 2015-ish, state-of-the-art computer for $4,000 has gigabytes of memory. And by the way, if you go back and look at history, in 1961, if you could build a machine capable of a gigaflop, it would have cost $18 billion. Today, it costs 8 cents. So, just give you an idea of what you can do for your $4,000 machine. So we've got gigabytes of memory, terabytes of disk, billions of operations per second, and running a problem on a PC of 6 million plus degrees of freedom is fairly commonplace. We run 3D time transient problems, we run multiple physics we do all sorts of interesting things. Computer memories, disks and everything else have grown by about 10 to the 5, but in fact problem size has only grown by about 10 to the 3. Well, the question is why, if everything else has gone up that big, the problem size has not grown that much. And that's largely because we can't figure out how to get things like solvers to scale linearly. So it just doesn't work properly for us at the moment. And that's an area where we need to start worrying. So you have four 3D solutions coming out, and you've all seen these, you can all do them. So bottom line, you've got for $4,000 you've got a terrific machine. You can get sufficient resolution at 6 million, 10 million degrees of freedom to represent a model. You can get very high accuracy solutions. That's what we've achieved in 41 years. We can represent nonlinear materials fairly well, we can do hysteresis, we can do geometric details. All of these are maybe not perfect yet, but we can at least attempt them. Excitations, not a big problem. But the big question is, have you got to where we set off, which was, can I actually model the real system with my simulation? Since that's the question that was asked in 1976. Have we achieved the initial goal? So we can provide forward solutions which simulate the world properly. Can we go so far as to say you never have to build a prototype? If you're in the big transformer industry or the big generator industry, you say, yes, we better have, because we ain't building a prototype of a $10, $20, $50 million device just to see if it works. It better work straight off the simulation. So just have a look at some stuff, and then I've got a couple of questions, which I guess I won't have time to ask the audience, so I'll have to answer them myself. This is a commercial surface-mounted permanent magnet machine built by a company called TM4. It's a motor drive for a car, or a generator about 40 kilowatts of peak power. It's an external rotor, and if we take a standard simulation system at the moment and run it on it, the prediction on the back EMF is within a percent of what was actually measured on the machine when it was built, and the torque speed curve is within a couple of percent. Pretty good. Great, so we're there. So you can all go home now, there's nothing else to do. Okay, so I'll take another surface mount, well, it's not quite a surface mount machine, but it's pretty close. It's a little one, it's a 12-slot 8-pole surface mount permanent magnet machine. And I do exactly the same piece of software, exactly the same set of analysis, and I do all the measurements, and then off that, hardly on the same sheet of paper. Same code. Same inputs. So now I'd say we haven't got anywhere near reality. Okay, let's just check this out. We'll go a little different speed, so this is roughly twice the speed, and same problems. Okay, well this isn't really a surface mount machine, so it's not quite the same as that. Let's make it surface mount, so it's now pretty much the same as the other machine, which is perfect. It's a little better, but there's still a huge discrepancy. What happens like IPM? Hang on, this is a bit odd. The IPM pretty well is dead on. Same code, almost the same machine. In fact, it's the same stator. We just changed the rotor geometry. We run the same code on this thing, and this one's pretty much perfect. So if I'm a design engineer, I've now got a problem. Was it or weren't it? Is it or isn't it? What's going wrong in the system? All the simulations used the same software, all took the same data from the materials and geometry, all were solved to the same accuracies. So why are some good and some bad? If I'm a designer, I want to know, because I don't get the luxury of building the machine and saying, the software doesn't work, or I can adjust it to make it work. It's got to work when I'm running blind. And the reason this doesn't work is because of errors in the manufacture. And it's the same stator, so it's not that the stator is different in all these cases, at least in the small machines. All the data came from the materials and the geometry, all were solved to the same accuracy. So why are some accurate and others not? And that's because of manufacturing errors. And in the second cases, when we got into it, the permanent magnet magnetizations were nothing like the manufacturers had specified. So how do you deal with that? And I know several people in the audience are worrying about this right now, or have been worrying for a while. So how does the virtual laboratory include manufacturing and operational variations? How do we build a robust design process which includes parameter variations in simulations? Hydrodynamics. problem as I saw as in China a couple of weeks ago, where somebody actually solved the full MHD problem. You just needed a supercomputer for it, but other than that, it was a very nice solution. Or should we be doing this more effectively? So is accuracy the only consideration? And if so, what does accuracy mean? What about measurement errors? You will notice on those measurement pictures, there were no error bars. They seem to have gone out of fashion. Estimating the error in your real device measurements doesn't seem to be something we can do. So I really don't know how good those simulations are, because I don't know what the errors in the measurement are. And the question is, what are the errors in the simulation? Are they the same? We know they're not. How do we do effective multi-physics going forwards? Do we use our computer power for multi-physics? I'll go back to the beginning of this talk. The goal here is to maximize the information gain, minimize the computational cost, and minimize the data that you need to gain the information that you've got to have to be able to get a good design out. And how much information gain you need versus computational cost depends on the problem. You can do a nice job in 2D on most motors. If you're trying to do a really big transformer, 2D isn't going to hack it. So it's problem dependent as to where you go. So what do we do with the growth in computer power? This is the last bit of the talk, and I've overrun by several minutes, so I apologize. I'm trying to get there. What can we do with it? What do we need to do? What are the trade-offs? Do we use the power for faster, smaller problems, or do we try to get nearer to real-world solutions? And if we do, can we get them right? Because we know the real world isn't that deterministic. So what do we do? And I think these three questions drive the R&D that we're seeing in the conference this week. Can we solve the problem and obtain sufficiently accurate answers for what the design engineer needs? Can we solve the problem more efficiently? And how does the solution fit inside the design process? And to solve the problem, do we have the right mathematics? Is the computer machinery powerful enough? And again, there's papers on that through the conference. Can we solve the problem more efficiently? Are there better algorithms than we're currently using, which have reduced complexity, they reduce the problem size, but leave us at the same accuracy at the end of the day? What accuracy do we need? Lower dimensionality, is it acceptable? Reduced all the models, can we do that? Are there other computer architectures? What's coming down the pipeline? Back in 1976, we were on mainframes, and we hardly saw the microprocessor revolution coming at us. And 5 or 6 years later, it was there. So what's coming? We already see multiple cores, distributed processors. What about an effective, low-cost, high-performance system? Should you take that computer power dedicated to a single problem? Remembering the design processes have a cost and time limit. Wall clock time is important, which I seem to be ignoring when I'm talking. What makes a cost-effective, high-performance computer? I'm going to skip through this a little quickly. We've hit the limits, as that graph showed, on single-core processors. Multi-core processors take us somewhere further, but communication speed's limited. But there's this thing called the cloud we keep hearing about. Gives you large numbers of interconnected processors, almost for free. How do you use this capability? And there's two ways you can do that. They're very parallel, so you can build parallel forms of existing algorithms, making one analysis run faster, but you've got into, as all of you will know, our parallel communication issues. And that leads to sublinear performance. Or you take those machines and run a lot of analyses in parallel. That's like testing 1,000 devices simultaneously, something you couldn't do physically. Look at the performance in space in parallel calculations, and that way you get almost linear gain in time, if it works for your problem. So that allows us to explore the design space. It allows us to look around the design point to see what manufacturing errors might bring in. And if you build a cloud computer, you can do that. So just to finish off with, I'll show you something fairly quickly. Fractional slot concentrated winding machine with 7 design variables and 2 design objectives, torque versus efficiency, line efficiency. So it's a 7-dimensional input space, a 2-dimensional output space. And we ran that up on the cloud. So it's 100 kilowatts IPM, so it's for design for driving trucks, delivery trucks. And we ran 1,000 variations of the design around the design point. And these are the plots you get out. These are the statistical scatter plots for looking at the torque versus the air gap thickness, the torque versus the magnet thickness, the magnet width, and so on. We built those 1,000 machines and tested them in less than 2 hours on a cluster of 48 virtual machines on the cloud. And the total cost of doing that was about $200. And for that, we got the performance of 1,000 machines out of the system. I'm not saying that's the way to go, but I'm saying that's an interesting possibility of the future. There's another game which is coming, and I thought I'd throw this one in because we're all worried about global warming and stuff, and that's part of the reason we do our jobs. Green computing. I don't see very much in this conference about how energy efficient our algorithms are, and maybe we should start worrying about it. People are starting to worry about minimizing the energy you use in solving a problem. How much energy do you consume? If you look towards our current 3D solution, which maybe runs for a week or so, and some of them do, on a top-of-the-line microprocessor system, you're running about 50 kilowatt hours to solve that problem. That's a fair amount of energy. Maybe we should be looking at some of this stuff. So just to conclude very quickly, over the last 40-odd years, we've seen massive gains in both analysis capability and computational technology, but are we using that power as effectively as we could? Simulation doesn't match reality because of variations in data, so how do we deal with that? How do we put errors into the simulation and match the real errors? High-performance computing systems, we can solve tens. In fact, some of the runs we've done 50,000 variants on the machine to look at its performance. And that satisfies that design need of maximizing information, minimizing cost and time. And multi-physics, maybe the cloud's the solution there. And then multi-objective optimization, which I haven't even touched on in this talk, but others will do. How do we implement multi-objective optimization so that it works as a design process? So thank you very much for your attention. That's where I wanted to finish. If you've got questions, I'll probably open the time for it. But thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much for setting the scene for this conference. I think it's been tradition of these conferences not to take questions after plenary lectures, but I'm sure Professor Lowther will be more than delighted to discuss it privately, perhaps, and take questions during